I cut myself shaving this morning. Can you see it? Geez, I haven't done that in a while. Oh well, that razor must have been dull. Good morning, folks. Happy Thursday. I'm drinking out of my cup I found. Why not? Stark and Hartman, right? That's Kelly Stoic. She's from Ohio, and she does Martin Zender stuff. Escape the box. www.martinzender.com. My brother in Christ, who preaches the evangel and teaches it from his car in Florida. So he's parked there and he does a show every day and he does an awesome job. He's bringing the evangel and the truth and he's waking people up and I love it. Today I am going to talk about something. Probably a lot of people, even brethren, have different opinions on this, but I'm going to bring it up. God is not mad at Billy Graham. As you know, that televangelist, the evangelist in the States, the kingpin of the Christian religion, one of them has passed away. He's gone to sleep, and God will raise him at the great white throne, I believe, and judge him there. But God is not mad at him. He has a love for Billy Graham. He actually gave Billy Graham what he has. He gave him his environment, he grew him up in wherever he grew up in, whatever territory, and literally gave him his whole life. Now, Billy Graham was set out to do what he had to do, and he didn't even realize it. He doesn't realize the love of God, the true love of God, and who God is. He actually doesn't know God the Father as we know him. And he preached a lot of falsehood. Yes, he did. For that, he will be judged for it. And it'll be at the Great White Throne. It's not a heinous judgment where he's sent off to some eternal fictitious torment in God's universe, a black spot, as it were. No, he's not. And God loves Billy Graham. God will judge him, he'll set him straight. And I just wanted to bring that up because a lot of people probably think, okay, well, he deserves it. He was the worst person ever. And mostly, I think brethren might think that. You know, God's going to judge him harshly. Well, yeah, he is, but he's going to set him straight. And it's not something that we need to dwell on. God's in control. He's always been in control and always will be in control of every detail of everybody's life. So, and that includes Billy Graham. I grew up in a Christian home. I went to several Billy Graham concerts and was forced to go forward by my foster mother, thinking I needed to be saved every time I went forward and was baptized and this and that. But that was a ritualistic religious thing, and I got through it. As harsh as it was, and the effects of it was necessary for my walk and my growth in the Lord. And God has given me more of a realization every day, every moment of every day of his love for me. My family is awesome. I am so thankful for everything in my life, good, bad, and ugly, because it produces the fruit of the Spirit. And this is what we need to be walking in, is the fruit of the Spirit, what God gives us. With that, I will read on here. I'm almost done this book. I'm over halfway through Check Your Panoply, and I'm going to finish it. I'm going to finish it and I'll start another book. Why? Because I enjoy the reading. I enjoy the learning. I learn a lot from what I'm reading to myself and reading on camera, which is so awesome. Okay, widening the range of faith. When we read the apostle's earliest epistle, which he wrote to the saints in Thessalonica, we can see his earnest desire to continue widening the range of faith of these young believers. Judging from his comment on Timothy's report, Paul was satisfied that his toil in that city had not been for naught. Now he knew of their faith. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 1 through 8. Hence he would not want to criticize it as if it were inadequate in amount. For instance, he would have no reason at all to call them scant of faith. And as a matter of fact, he never uses this expression, scant of faith, meaning, I guess, a small portion of faith. We each have a measure of faith, yes, but each one has been given it. Whether it's small or big, it does not matter. it grows in the Lord. It occurs only in Matthew and in Luke when our Lord wanted to encourage his little flocklet not to worry about eating and drinking and clothing. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 30 through 34, and Luke chapter 12, verse 27 through 32, when the apostles on the lake were afraid of drowning because of the storm, when Peter hesitated to continue walking on the water, when the disciples worried about their next meal, after the Lord had fed 5,000 people with 5 cakes of bread, and again 4,000 with 7 cakes. In Matthew chapter 16, verse 7 through 12, and when the signs and miracles which accompanied the kingdom proclamation were gradually vanishing, and the disciples were unable to cure the epileptic son. In Matthew chapter 17, verse 14 through 20. Here the Lord called their unbelief scant faith. All these occurrences, however, are relevant to the kingdom proclamation, and the term scant of faith is used only in connection with some physical need, as we have seen. Since our Lord is the only one who ever used the terms under consideration, it follows that at the same time no one else felt entitled to do so. Being under grace, even a man like Paul would never dare call anyone scant of faith. Judgment and criticism in the sphere is strictly reserved to the Lord. The deficiencies of your faith. Now we will admit that Paul had something different in mind when he wrote, "For what thanksgiving are we able to repay to God concerning you for all the joy with which you are rejoicing because of you in front of our God, night and day super excessively beseeching to see your face and to adjust the deficiencies of your faith." 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 9 and 10. The apostle does not consider the Thessalonians' faith as being too scanty. It is rather the deficiencies in their knowledge of the truth to which he is pointing. He wants to add a new truth to their range of faith, such as developed in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13 through 18, where we read, "The Lord himself will be descending from heaven, and the dead in Christ shall be rising first. Thereupon we, the living who are surviving, shall at the same time be snatched away together with them in clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus shall we always be together with the Lord, so that console one another with these words." Okay, so that passage is tremendous. That's our snatching away. And the dead in Christ will be rising first. And we, the living, will be snatched away together with them in clouds to meet our Lord in the air. Putting on the cuirass of faith and love. While Paul in Ephesians 6:14 uses the term cuirass in order to describe the security afforded by righteousness, he employs the same figure of speech in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 8, to emphasize the general protection presently given by sober faith and gracious love. During the secret administration of the grace of God, in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 2 and 9, true faith does not look for signs, but rather believe such divine declarations as given in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13 through 18. Gracious love should characterize all our contacts with fellow saints and fellow men, acknowledging those over us and patiently bearing with those below us. Only when we stand firm in the faith and let all our actions occur in love. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 13 and 14. Only then can we fully enjoy the salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for our sakes, that whether we are watching or drowsing, we should be living together at the same time with him, consoling one another with divine declarations. And faith and love together will prompt us to follow the apostles' admonitions given in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 11 and 12. Consoled together through one another's faith. After Timothy had been sent to the Thessalonians to establish and console them for the sake of their faith, and had come back bringing with him the evangel of their individual faith and love, the apostle was indeed consoled through their faith, and was able to repay thanksgiving to God for them and beseech him for an opportunity to readjust the deficiencies in the range of their faith, as we have seen. Now the Thessalonians were not only ones whose individual faith toward God had come out. all over Macedonia and Achaia and everywhere, we find similar line of thought in the first part of Romans chapter 1, verse 8 through 12. First, indeed, I am thanking my God through Jesus Christ concerning all of you, that your faith is being announced in the whole world. For God is my witness, to whom I am offering divine service in my spirit, in the evangel of his Son. How unintermittently I am making mention of you, always in my prayers, beseeching, if somehow, sometime, at length, I should be prospered in the will of God to come to you. For I am longing to see you, and I may be sharing some spiritual grace with you for you to be established. Yet this is to be consoled together among you through one another's faith, both yours and mine. Okay, I'm going to stop there today. So, as I said at the top of the show, God is giving each one a measure of faith. And basically, he will give that faith to all eventually. He will give it by sight. We have it now in spirit, without perception. Then everybody will have it with perception, because they will see God and they will know him right away. Everything will be exposed. They will be naked before God. Everything that you've ever done in this lifetime, thought, done, every action will be exposed to God. And that is the purpose of the Great White Throne, to get rid of the bad and bring reconciliation back to God through his Son, Christ Jesus, who died on that cross for all our sins, that it may be exposed to God's love. So with that, I will say grace and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Happy Thursday. We will see you tomorrow. Escape the box.